you so much. We'll see if this camera works or not. I haven't figured out the pattern. But I'm gonna crack you. So let's see. In terms of other announcements, your next thing up, I mean, essentially your deliverables for this class are actually relatively small at this point, right? You have your last homework and your final project. But remember, your final project is worth like most of your grade. And so you really should do it and do it carefully. The people that have come to my office hours with questions and debugging and stuff, I'm really impressed with like the quality and the level of interest and all the kind of diverse things that you guys are working on, which is great. What that means for those of you who haven't been in my office hours is that you have some stiff competition. Let's see. In terms of other announcements, I think there's two more nano quizzes in this class. This Sunday, should you be interested, there's the New England Symposium on graphics. No, to the person that emailed me about extra credit, you will not receive extra credit for attending this event, nor will you make your instructor happier or less happy about your project grade. It is simply out of interest. I know we have a lot of graphic students in the room, and if you'd like, there's this event on Sunday, and it's completely orthogonal to anything we do in 6th to 8th grade. Are there any other questions? Good. Okay, so remember that last time we embarked upon sort of developing this dual theory to vector fields, right? For every vector field, there's this field of one form, which is this thing that takes dot products of vectors. And somehow for certain, at least notationally, and in certain kind of mathematical cases, that's easier to work with than the vector field itself, right? So remember roughly we defined a one form as a dual of a vector, and apparently you guys all got that because you did okay on your quiz. And this funny intuition we had is this like, this bizarre device that I almost spent $6 on and then thought the better of, which is essentially it's like measuring layers of an onion, right? That's sort of, you think of the one form as the onion and the input of the one form as this blue hairy thing. And sort of as I stick it into the onion in different ways, the onion tells me how many layers I passed through. And so the onion is like our one form, right? It tells me how many layers you're passing through. And this is sort of the dual of a vector, which is like the distance between everyone. Or if you like, the one form is like the row vector to the vector column. Yeah, the column vector. Oh, you already talked about a lot of this. Right, so when we talk about vector fields, we could just as easily talk about what people call a differential one form, which is an assignment of one form acting on the tangent space to every point on a surface. Yeah? Okay. Right, we talked about how to get line integrals and two-form, all this kind of stuff out of this. Great. And I think we stopped about here. So we defined, and so remember that we have one forms and two forms, and what is an alternating K form? It's a function of K vectors instead of just one, and it's linear in each of its K slots, right? And if I take any of those two K inputs to my function and I swap their order, and I leave everything else in the same order, then what do I get? Negative what you have before. That's the alternating form of the alternating K form. Right? This is different from a symmetric K form where you get the same value. So we said, well, there are a lot of different ways to go from one form to two forms, and it's kind of like a cross product, right? Cross products have kind of a similar structure. If I take the cross product of A cross B, it's equal to minus B cross A, so sort of it looks similar in nature. And indeed, we define this object called a wedge product of two one forms, which is kind of the cross product of the one form world. Yeah, and in fact, I mean, if you look at this formula here, it's pretty clear that these things are related. Yeah. So then I think where we left off, we defined the symbol of a permutation. Remember, this is negative 1 to the number of flips that it takes from one thing to another. And then I gave you this beautiful piece of notation. And the idea is, essentially what we're trying to do is multiply like a K form and an L form and get a K plus L form. Right? But the problem is that This K plus L form that we're going to get has to be alternating, right? And you can just try this at home. If you just take two like one forms and you just kind of multiply the value together, you don't get an alternating function back, right? And so essentially the way that we defined at the biggest level of generality how we're going to multiply forms together is it's sort of like what we're going to do is take every possible product and then put this epsilon, the sign of the permutation in front of the product. The idea being that sort of, this is what's going to make it alternating. We're just going to keep permuting around all the inputs and assigning the right sign to it. Yes, Sebastian?
Should we sigma 1 of the sigma k, sigma 2 of the sigma k?
In the forms. Where are we? The second line here?
No. Well, yeah. Second line in the song. So you have the...
Oh, yes. Yep. And we now have our first mistake code. This should be sigma of 1 to sigma of k, and the sigma of k plus 1. Because these are all the different ways you can permit to run all the inputs. So you can cut it again to class, I'll fix that one. You can see, I really just don't like teaching this particular topic. But anyway, even if you don't want to remember this formula, essentially there are a couple of properties that it turns out are sufficient to derive this formula. And that's these things I've given you at the bottom of the slide. That the wedge product is it's almost anti-symmetric. So if you wedge a k-form and an l-form and you swap their order, you get minus 1 to the kl. So it's almost anti-symmetric. So if I wedge a 2-form and a 3-form, and I swap the order, in fact, I actually get the same thing back. I don't get minus, right? Because this would be minus 1 to the 6. No? It's associative, meaning I can group this product in the way that I want. It's distributive. And if I wedge something in itself, I get 0. Right? This looks just like a cross product. That's the way to think about it. So remember that we have this basis for one forms that we talked about actually before our Yano quiz a little bit, right? This is like dx1 to dxk. For every pair of those guys, right, I could take their wedge, and what I end up with is a basis for like two forms, right? So in particular, let's say that I am in the two forms over R3. Yeah? So first of all, what is the basis for the 1 forms over R3? It's dx, 1, dx, 2, dx, 3, did I do that right? right. So then what is our basis for 2 forms? Well, what we could do, because we know that we can take any 1 form and write it in this basis, right? And then presumably we can kind of get every 2 form by wedging 1 form. So in fact, we showed that in the last lecture. So what I can do is just take the wedge of every pair of these guys. Right? So in particular, dx1 wedge dx1, dx1 wedge dx2, dx1 wedge dx3. I'm not going to write all of these, I promise. dx2 wedge dx1, and so on. Right? If I write it like this, is this a basis? Raphael says no. Why is it not a basis?
Well, for one, there's 9 different things.
But we know the dimensionality of this space is small. Right? We kind of mentioned 3.
Yeah.
And why? What have I done wrong? What is this wedge?
0.
This is 0. And for example, what is the relationship between these two guys?
Maybe.
This is minus each other. Okay. So anyway, at the end of the day, this is how you come up with basis for forms, and you can check it when you get 3 of them, right? So you get dx1 wedge dx2, dx1 wedge dx3, and dx2 wedge dx3. That's right. Yeah, everything else is right. Cool. Does that make sense? And how big is the space of 3 forms over R3? What's the dimension of it? You're very subtle. You could just say it's 1. The candle in the wind kind of set up, it's a little hot. Yeah, and what is, and somebody else, what is the actual basis there? Like the what point vector expands that set of three forms over R3? Sebastian, what vector, what spans that set?
The x1, dx2, dx3.
Exactly. Right, we kind of know that because these three indices all have to be between 1 and 3. And if I have any 2 repeat, that's really equal to 0. So this is like the only thing that's left, yeah? Okay, thank you. All right, so that's wedge product. Cool, so this is like some generalization of the cross product. This also kind of answers the question, like if you take linear algebra class and like you go to all this work to define dot products and cross products, and you notice that dot products like lift naturally to whatever dimensional space, and then you ask this dirty question, which is like, well, what about the cross product? Why do we spend all this time doing this and it's only in 3D? And the answer is that really, you have to go to the work of understanding of k-forms before you can do that. And different dimensionalities have very different kind of notions of cross products. Oops. Oh, man. Don't make me teach this on the board. Oh, God, there's one way to make this worse. It says projector is powering down. That's the opposite of what I want. Right. Okay. So far, we haven't really done geometry in a sense, right? We've basically just been developing algebra. Right? Remember, in linear algebra, roughly, you get all of your geometry from what? From dot products, in a sense, right? We're like measuring lengths of things. So without the dot product, you can have like a vector space, like the space of polynomials, to be an example. But you need a dot product in order to actually measure, right? So the question is, can I see anything on the projector screen?
It's powering up.
Okay, so the question is, can I measure the length of the dot product of different k-folds, right? So first of all, how would I measure the dot product of two one-forms? Does anybody have any hypothesis? What should I do to have like kind of a self-consistent picture? Well, remember, a one-form is just a fancy way of encoding what? Fancy, what does it encode? What's that example? The dot product with what? A vector, right? Yeah. So one-form is just a fancy way of encoding a vector, right? So if I take dot products of one-forms, somehow I'd better agree with dot products of vectors. Yeah? But remember, we have at our disposal a way to go from one-forms to vectors. Does anybody remember what it is? Sharp, exactly. Good, we're talking. So if I want, here's xi, and here's nu, because for some reason in my slides, I decided to put the two Greek symbols I can never draw, and I want the inner product, well, as Matthew suggests, what I'm going to do is define it. I haven't given you a dot product, so now this is a definition. I'm going to say, well, I do know how to take, see, this is why I hate these letters. I do know how to make them into vectors, by taking their shirk, and I do not take dot product. So this is a definition of a dot product. Exactly, what is the dot product of zero forms? Or inner form? What is a zero form? This is like a function, right? It's a number. Right? So the product of zero forms is just a product. Oh, we have slides. Cool. Okay. More generally, if you'd like to go from the inner product of one form to the inner product of k forms, this gets a little tricky. Surprise. So you can only take, remember that it only makes sense to kind of take dot products inside of a Hilbert space. Like, it doesn't make sense to take a dot product of a k-form and an l-form because they come from like two different worlds, right? Because like dot product is something in itself would be its length, and then like what the heck would that mean? But the dot product of a k-form and another k-form is described here. This is a little bit tricky. So what you do is essentially you take let's see if I get this right. You define, as an axiom, you say, I'm going to just define the inner product of a k-form that's the wedge of k one-forms. Right? And it turns out that's good enough, right? That you write every k-form this way. And essentially what you do is you construct a matrix out of every possible pair of these things that you're wedging. Right? Like, so you take one here, take one there, and then you take its determinant. And you can check that it agrees with this definition for one-forms. So for instance, let's say that I have two forms, like V wedge W and A wedge B here. Notice that they're flat, so really these are vectors, and then I've made them one forms by taking their flat, and then I've wedged them to make two forms. If this is frustrating, it should be, because this notation is really terrible. You can't emphasize that enough. Let's say I wanted to take the inner product, right? Well, maybe we can just look at this slide. This is not so bad. So do you see how this notation on the top translates to what we do in practice? Essentially, you take the dot product between every pair of vectors, one from the first, one from the second, and make that into a matrix, and it takes determinant. And just like as a fun fact, one thing you can check at home is that it's equal to the second expression here. It's called a quadruple product. Somehow, the really kind of interesting thing about differential k-forms is like no matter what you do to them, you get like some kind of geometric measure out, right? Like this is somehow surprising. Right? And in fact, we saw this second formula before, right? This is the definition of the wedge. Yeah, so all this stuff kind of fits together. Which is nice, because if you make a mistake, it's only going to be a sign mistake, right? So it must be hard to make any other mistake. Okay. So finally, as you can see, we're developing this algebra, right? Like, we have these different spaces, we have like k-form, you know, one form, two forms, three forms, whatever. By the way, what are the four forms on R3? What are they? Do they exist? No. Talked about that last time, right? Because then you'll have a repeated index. You have four numbers. And all of them are drawn between 1 and 30, then you repeat. What do we call this? Pigeonhole principle? There's got to be one that repeats. Right, but anyway, our whole job here is to just sort of take geometry and write it in an algebraic way. Right? So now we have products, That's provided from the wedge. But there's one more notion that's kind of useful, and this is specific to k-forms. In fact, to make matters worse, it's specific to k-forms over Rn, that both of those numbers are going to matter. And the idea is that there's somehow a duality, in case you haven't heard that word enough in this class, there's somehow a duality between k-dimensional things and n minus k-dimensional things. Yeah? So for example, think of a plane through the origin in 3D. Right? What would be one way to define a plane? So a plane is a two-dimensional object. 3 minus 2 is equal to?
1.
Finally, a question somebody will answer. So sort of the duality we would expect with one-dimensional objects. And what is a one-dimensional object that defines a plane through the origin? Any ideas? What's that?
Normal.
The normal vector, right? So every plane, which is a two-dimensional object, there's a one-dimensional object that's like completely equivalent that would define that plane. It's a normal vector, right? And similarly, remember that we kind of talked about, like, for example, two forms over R2 are like little bits of area that are little squares, right? Well, you can think of that as some scalar times just like the area of a unit square, right? So some of this, there's this duality between k-dimensional things and n minus k-dimensional things that we're going to capture, right? So how do you think we're going to do that? Well, what we're going to do is define an operator that we call a hot star that goes from k forms to n minus k forms. Matt, this is probably where your Math 52H skills from Stanford drop off, because I don't think they covered this. So in particular, I was trying to think of the right way to define this object. And of course, everybody has their own. Keenan kind of just draws a picture, which is, you know, what we just discussed, right? That some of a wedge of forms looks like a little parallelogram, and a one form is like a vector, so somehow these all fit together. I was trying to find a proof that, like, this is actually what happens. And of course, there's a lot of philosophical language, although not a whole lot of math. So what I came up with was this sort of derivation here. So in particular, we're going to say that capital lambda to the p, this is the space of p forms, right? So this is like spanned by the wedge of p one forms, yeah? Okay. And now, let's say that I take a form, and I'm going to put him in n minus p forms, right? So n's going to be our dimensionality here, right? So the Hochstar of this thing is going to be a what? Just from the sort of philosophy I've laid out for you. What is the dual of an n minus p form in Rn? Eric, what's the dual of an n minus p form in Rn?
N minus p form.
So it is n p. Minus n minus p. P form,
yes,
exactly.
P.
Okay. I'm going to start calling you guys if you want to. Yeah. Now that I know most of your names, this is dangerous. Yeah. Okay. So what we're going to do is define a map that's defined in terms of this n minus p form u. And what it does is it takes as input. Oh. Shenanigans, I already screwed it. That's okay. Alright, I'm gonna change my notation on the fly, which is always dangerous. So it's going to take as input a P form, and it's gonna map it to mu wedge lambda. What is this object? I just wedged a P form and an N minus P. What is this beast?
An N form?
An N form, right? This is what happens when you take away yourself. I'm going to make this painful to do this right now. So this map is a linear map. Do you see that? If I add together two lambdas here, then I could have added together their image under this map to get these N forms. Yeah? So this map is. Right? And in particular, what this implies is that there exists some function which is parameterized by mu here. Right? And what is it going to do? Well, remember, how big is the dimension? dimensionality of the n forms over Rn, one, that we've seen in pattern time, right? So in other words, I could take this thing such that mu wedge lambda is equal to times dA, right? Because this is the only kind of basis one form that I need. You see that? So what this thing is doing, this F sub mu, is it takes an input lambda, and it gives me back the coefficient of dA that I get when I take this wedge. Yeah? What can you say about this map F? Anybody have any ideas? Well, this map is actually linear, yeah?
Right.
And so, in particular, this map is linear, and what does that give me? Right, so this gives me the wedge, and from forms and gives me a scalar back, right? So in other words, there exists star mu, which is in the P forms, right? Such that F mu scalars, right? And the only functions that go from forms to scalars are essentially just dot products. That's all you can do, right? So what's hiding underneath here is that there has to exist some form, this is star mu, such that our function f sub mu is the thing that's implicitly it's taking the dot products with. And this object is the star of mu. So even if you can get that, we're gonna do some computations with it, just a moment. Right? So anyway, this is something that at least argues that it exists, and now the question is, well, what the hell does this thing do? Yeah, and in fact, in two dimensions, so first of all, what is the star of a one form over R2? What kind of a form is it? Jared, what kind of a form is the star of a one form over R2?
Is it a one?
Yes, because 2 minus 1 is 1. Okay. And in particular, it turns out that the star operator just rotates by 90 degrees. That's all it does. So let's actually prove that here. Hopefully this won't be a total disaster. And in your homework, I have you do essentially the same calculation in 3D. Actually, we'll do this over here. Okay, so what we're going to do is, let's say that I take U to be a one form. So in other words, we can write this in a fancy way. Like that. So it's a one form over R2. Hopefully you're getting the notation now. Okay. Remember, we have a basis for this. Namely, I can write u equals u1 dx. Yeah, crap. This is upper one. Did I get that right or did I flip it back again? No, I got that right. Okay. So now let's take another one form and we'll call him w. Right? So in particular, cool. So first of all, what we're going to do is we're going to, kind of following this calculation over here, but we're going to make it more concrete. We're going to take the wedge of U and W. It's good practice anyway. Yeah? So, what is U wedge W? Well, okay, so it's u1 dx1 plus u2 dx2 wedge w1 dx1 plus w2 dx2. Yeah? Okay. Well, now let's think about what happens, right? So This is distributive. You asked me if I have dx1 wedge dx1. What do I get? Everybody?
Zero.
Zero. Good. Okay, so we clearly need a dx1 wedge dx2 term here. Do we need any other term? No, right? This spans the two forms of R2. Yeah. So in particular, dx1 wedge dx2 is going to give you u1 w2. But now we're going to get dx2 dx1, so I have to swap their order. Right? And when I do that, I incur a minus 1 charge. You know, so I have minus u2 w1, like that. Okay. So remember, based on my slightly stuttered little explanation on the right-hand side, you can think of the star of a form as the object so that when I get here, I want to take the inner product, right? So, okay, well, remember that we want the star of u, yeah? And when I take u wedge w, I get this, right? So this is the dot product between w and what vector? You see this? It's actually a little bit tricky. It's minus u2 comma u1. Right? That this function is equal to the dot product of that and w1 w2. You see that? Is that what I wrote here? So we define the wedge product to be the thing, or not the wedge product, rather the hash term, be the thing so that when you take the wedge and get a full dimensional form, you get the inner product. Remember, let's take a 2x2 determinant. Yeah? So, what is that thing? Well, in this case, it's the dual of minus u2 comma 1, u1. So in other words, what we get, that u star is equal to what? It's equal to minus u2 dx1 plus u1 dx2, but of course, if I took the sharp of this, like I made it into a vector, right? This is like multiplying by the matrix 0, minus 1, 1, 0, which just rotates 90 degrees. Yeah? This should tell you a lot about what the Hochstar is doing. Right? The Hochstar is essentially somehow hiding in this one little innocent-looking operator is all of the geometry of your problem. Right? In particular, it knows how to rotate stuff, like in this case by 90 degrees. In your homework, you're going to work out what this means in 3D. I'll give you a hint, kind of looks like the miters of a matrix. What else can it do? Well, it kind of knows something about dot products, right? So hiding inside of the Hochstar, it turns out, is basically all you need to do geometry. Right? This is kind of surprising. Okay. Right, so this is the picture you should have. All star does is rotate the complexity. But this is specifically for one forms over 2D space. Yep. Right, so basically what we've done so far only cares about one space, like, you know, one form over R2, but of course, remember, we care about differential K forms, which means the K form attached to every point on the surface, or on the, yeah? And so now we're going to go back to that language. Cool? So, first of all, like I've already defined for you here, this lambda to the K means the space of alternating K multilinear forms, or just K forms, is what you should say. And I'm going to define omega K to be the assignment of one of those per tangent plane. Yeah. Like, remember, like this looks like fancy notation, but hopefully this doesn't lose you. Like, think about what a vector field is. It's an assignment of one vector per tangent plane. This is just somehow the same thing for forms. Yeah. Okay. And now we can start to talk about, you know, in case our notation wasn't messy enough, we're going to start building even more and putting operators that have to do with the geometry of the manifold. Right? So far we've just talked about the geometry of Rn. Now we have to introduce the geometry of our curved space that these guys are sitting on top of. And so, as a first example, if I want to take the inner product of K forms, what can I do? Or a differential K form is the assignment of K form to every point. And remember, if I wedge a K form and an N minus K form, what do I get? Everybody? Close, an N form. And I have an N-dimensional manifold, yeah? Well, remember, there's only one N form. It's the area element. It's like dA when I take an integral. Right? So when I wedge this thing, this is a fancy way for saying this is some scalar times dA on your manifold. You see how this all works out very nicely? Because what did I do? I took the dual of one of these forms, and then when you add up the two dimensionalities, you get exactly what you want. Yeah. Right. So this is how we can integrate forms. What's missing is how we can differentiate them. And if you remember back to Misha's lecture a couple weeks ago, right? He talked all about differentiating vector fields. This is going to be kind of like the same thing, but now acting on forms instead of vector fields. And one of the really surprising things is that there's like a unique derivative that's acting on k-forms, whereas there's like about six different derivatives that all work on act on vector fields. Remember, there's covariant and Lie and all this stuff. So now the picture is much cleaner here. So to do so, we're going to go back to everybody's least favorite definition, which is the differential of a map. And in this case, it's enough to have a map into the real numbers. Remember when I say a map from a surface into the real numbers? This is like very fancy language for assigning one number per point on a surface. That's all it means. And the question is, how do I differentiate that? And remember, we actually defined the gradient of a function, like that vector field, in kind of a funny way, right? What we said is we're going to take our surface, you know, at a point P. I'm going to start drawing curves through P, right? And I want to take the directional derivative in the direction of the tangent to that curve at P. And what we proved in class, I think in week two of this course, is that that's actually independent of exactly the choice of curve that you choose. It only depends on the tangent of the curve at P. Right? We call that map the differential. And then what we showed when we talked about the gradient of a function is that that is really taking the dot product with some vector. Right? This is kind of backward. And all we have to do here is just ignore that second half. Right? The differential is just going to be, well, so I have this map F, which goes from your surface S into the real numbers, and I'm going to take a point on our surface. Now, I take a vector in the tangent plane, and I take any curve that goes through that vector. And what happens when I restrict F to that curve? What I get is a function from the real numbers to the real numbers, right? From like where you are along that curve to the value of your function on that curve. And I can differentiate that. I know how to differentiate functions. Yeah? And that's the value that I defined for my number. This is all review. And then what we had to prove is that this doesn't depend on your choice of alpha as long as it goes to the point and agrees with the tangent. Yeah? Okay. Well, now we have a very fancy name for this object. So first of all, what is a function in differential forms, like an assignment of one number per point on the surface? What do we call this object?
Zero
form. Right? This is a fancy name. And so now what we're going to call this is the exterior derivative of a zero form. Notice that this letter D stands for exterior derivative. Now you see where we get exterior calculus. It's the exterior derivative. Why this is called exterior derivative, I don't know, actually. Okay. So remember, this is all fancy. So let's say that I wanted to write the gradient of a function in terms of notation we've developed in the last two lectures. How would I do that? Massey actually got us half of the way there a minute ago, right? Remember, when we took dot products of one forms, what did we do? We took this sharp, right? So this goes from one forms to vectors. How do I go from functions or zero forms to one forms? I take D, yeah? Let's put these things together. In other words, if I want the gradient of a function, you know, so I have F goes from my surface into the real numbers, right? And I want the gradient of F. Remember, this assigns what? It assigns a vector in every tangent plane? Well, so we're taking Massey's suggestion, we do df, right? This gives me an operator at every point that differentiates the function in that direction. And then I take the sharp. Yeah? And so you can see there's kind of a one-to-one correspondence between like vector notation that we all know and love from calculus class and notation here. And the extra credit problem in your homework is going to work this all out. So if you have spare time in the next couple of weeks, I really encourage you to try this because it's like a great exercise in pain and understanding. Where essentially what it asks you to do is translate like div, grad, and curl into d's and stars. And you can show you can do all of those. Yes, Kelsey?
So here we're taking the gradient and then the sharp converts it to a vector?
Yeah, so remember that df is this funny operator at every point that takes in a tangent vector and gives me the directional derivative of f in that tangent direction? And it turns out, well, this is a linear operator on a single vector at every point on the surface. So this object is a one form, and remember I go from one form to a vector by applying the sharp, and so this gradient that you defined a few lectures ago, this is just a different way of writing it. This is df sharp. Okay. So how's that for fancy? You get music signs in there, you get derivatives, the whole thing, everything you could possibly do. So now the next question is how do you construct an exterior derivative for forms that are of higher order than just a zero form. Yeah? God, like, what does it mean to take D of a 1 form? And typically, there's like a very formal definition, kind of like there's a formal definition of the wedge where you take like every possible wedge and kind of stick them all together. Essentially, you can do a similar thing here to get D of a 1 form. But I was trying to think of like what is the best way to explain this. And from a topological perspective, what I came up with was on this screen. Which, let's say I ask a question. There's some set of 1 forms on my surface that are really D of 0 forms. Yeah? And there's some 1 forms for which that's not the case, they're just 1 forms, right? Like, in other words, I have some way of going from 0 forms to 1 forms, but I didn't show that it covers the whole space of 1 forms. Does that make sense? So I might ask you the question, which is, when is a 1 form really D of a 0 form? Yeah, I could ask that question if I wanted to. And so the way that we're going to go about that is what's shown. So, in particular, well, I have to show you the screen. So let's say that I have a 1 form alpha, and I'm going to write in the dx basis, our favorite basis here, the coefficients f sub I. Yeah? My question is alpha d of a 0 form? Yeah? Well, how could I do that? Well, let's say that I have a 0 form, a function, f. So remember, I'm going to write in omega 0 of our surface. Right? That's our fancy notation for functions. Yeah. All right. And in particular, at some point p, we can write that f d of other is equal to what? Well, one thing you can check at home is that, which is sort of what you would expect, is this equal to df dx. Why does this make sense, by the way? What is hiding here? This is like the gradient of f, right? So this is the operator that takes dot products with the gradient of f. Notice it fits together, this is really the right thing to do. Yeah? So, okay, and meanwhile I have this 1 form alpha equal to the sum over alpha over I, let's say that's I. I guess I wrote f sub I, maybe this is not clear. No? So, in particular, what does this mean? This means that alpha I is equal to the partial derivative of f in the xi direction. Yeah? So what do we know about partial second derivatives of a function? If I take the second derivative like dx dy, or I take the second derivative of a function dy dx, I get the same thing. Yeah? So in other words, what did I learn? I never understood what this third board is for. It kind of topologically you could never write it, right? Like it was like never. Okay. So because of this, d squared f dxi dxj is equal to d squared f dxj dxi for all x, y, j, right? This is just a fact in calculus class, right? But what does that imply about these alpha i's? This implies that d alpha I dxj equal to d alpha j dxi. Can you see that? All I did was plug in this expression here. Okay. Well, it's a very fancy way of writing. So for one thing, let's subtract like that. Yeah. Okay. Well, what could I have done? Well, one way of getting this minus, remember that dxi wedge dxj, dxj wedge dxi are minus each other, right? So in particular, for fun, I could have, well, one thing, I could take this thing and multiply it on both sides by dx1, dxi wedge dxj, just for fun. I could multiply on both sides, right? So I would get finally, What am I gonna do? I'm gonna write this, and notice I'm kind of like unfolding notation here, and then we're just gonna kind of stick all the arrows that go in the reverse direction. This is equal to d alpha I d x j d x I wedge d x j plus d alpha j d x I on d x I wedge d x j. Did I do that right? I didn't do that right. So all I did was I took the second term and I flipped the order of this wedge. Hopefully, yeah. And I wrote it here. Yes, can I
write it? The subscripts changed.
Ah. Okay, fine. Okay. You happy now? Okay. All right. So notice what I did here. Right? Well, now this is starting to look like some kind of definition of derivative, right? What I'm going to do is take every component of alpha, so this is like I, right, all the different coefficients of alpha, and differentiate it to each j, right? And then just kind of stick a wedge on the right-hand side for the variable that I differentiated. Yeah? And in general, this is going to be my definition of the differential form. So this is just by definition. That this is, what I'm going to do is just sum over every possible way to differentiate one superscript and one subscript and wedge them all together. This is called the differential form. And the way to, the exterior derivative, rather, and the way to think about it is that essentially what the exterior derivative provides you is a condition under which a k form is d of a k minus 1 form. Right? That's what we checked here. And notice, what did I get? I got a 2 form when I did that. Right? If I wanted to check maybe 1 form was d of a 0 form, then I need to check maybe 2 form equals 0. Yeah? Yes, Sebastian?
Is this equivalent to d df is equal to 0, essentially?
What was that?
D df is equal to 0.
D df.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yep, working at that same. But in general, when I want to check if alpha is d of f, then all I have to really do is check if d of alpha equals 0. What I do is differentiate every possible way and take a wedge, and then notice that if I flip the order of the wedge, I change the sign. Yes?
So is this why like a conservative vector field is curl free?
Yes. This is exactly why a conservative vector field is curl convective. No. Yeah. This is all fancy notation that's going to unify everything we know about vector calculus. Yeah. Okay, so here's the thing. This given d on 0 forms, this gave me a d on a 1 form. You see that? Now that I have d on a 1 form, I can use the same pattern to get d on a 2 form, and I can iterate, right? So this just by chaining upward gives me all the exterior derivatives I want. But luckily on surfaces, it turns out this is all we need, right? Because there's no such thing as anything higher than a 2 form. Right. Okay. So another way of defining this, if you don't like this, is that you can define it axiomatically, where you say the d of a 0 form agrees with gradient, like it's a gradient because we know how to define that, right? And then there's this particular rule about how to differentiate wedge products, which kind of just looks like the product rule from calculus class with a minus one thrown in because you'd be careful about order. And this third property, which is exactly what we're asking about, which is called exactness, which is d of d equals 0, which is essentially what we checked, right? D squared of f, where f is a 0 form, gives me 0 by definition. Okay. I think we all have the intuition for problems. That concludes our list of operators. You can all breathe a sigh of relief. So what do we have? We have d, we have star, and we have wedge, right? And so wedge is kind of like a cross product. Yeah. Star is this duality, like it takes planes to their normals, and then d is a directional derivative, but it kind of mixes commuting derivatives in such a particular way. Okay. I know this is confusing. Nobody likes this stuff. Literally nobody. Okay. Canvas has that at all. Okay. So, right. So the reason we kind of like this stuff, remember that we talked about like two forms on a sphere as kind of like little flux sensors? Right? That should remind you of a surface integral, right? Like a surface integral is just measuring the total flux through a surface, and it's like a little differential version of that. Right? So the reason that a lot of people, especially in real analysis, really like differential forms is they give you a very careful way of defining a surface integral. Yeah, and so really we can talk about integrating a k-form over a k-dimensional manifold, right? Because in that case you only have one space of k-forms, right? And that's just like dA, right? So In particular, let's say that I wanted to differentiate a one form, which is like a vector field, over a curve. Right? Well, how should I think about this? Well, what is it doing? It's like taking the tangent to your curve, taking the dot product of that tangent with your vector field, and then integrating with respect to r. A very slick way of putting it. Right? So see, omega of t is just the dot product between your field and t. Both of you guys are seeing this duality. And the reason that we go about that is that if you go, remember at the very beginning of our last lecture, we talked about like there's Stokes' theorem, there's the divergence theorem, there's the fundamental theorem of calculus. I just learned a new one the other day, which is the Reynolds flux theorem for tensors. Anyway, all of these things involve differentiate something, integrate on the inside, or integrate the thing on the boundary. They all kind of aesthetically look the same. And it turns out, you can check that they are all this theorem right here. That the integral of d of a form over region omega is equal to the boundary integral of not d. So first of all, let's check if this makes sense, right? So let's say that I have a two-dimensional region, right? Then d omega had better be a two form, so omega had better be what?
One form,
yeah. So this is the integral of a two form over a two-dimensional region. And look what happens. So what is the boundary of a two-dimensional region? It's a curve, which is one-dimensional. And indeed, I'm integrating a one form over that boundary. So it all fits together. Yeah? And it turns out that this is all just all of these different theorems that you know from multivariable calculus all fit into this one little piece of notation. We're not going to prove it in this class because that would take a few lectures. Okay. So one thing that Sebastian asked about a minute ago is that if you take d squared, it equals 0, right? Remember I took a function, I took d of it once, and then I took d of it again, and I get 0 because, you know, for a function, the partial derivative is commute, and that's essentially exactly what the exterior derivative is measuring. And the question is, can I understand it in this context, even if I don't like that notation? And the answer, obviously, because I'm saying it now, is yes. So let's say that I'm integrating d squared omega over a region. Then by Stokes' theorem, I can instead integrate over the boundary of omega, d of omega. Yeah? It's a little omega, big omega. I'm sorry, it's common notation. Yeah? Remember, the boundary curve is just this outer part. And what is the boundary of a boundary curve? Same episode. This thing doesn't have a boundary. Yeah? So if I apply Stokes' theorem twice, I'm integrating over an empty set, and I get 0. Yeah? So in fact, this identity d squared equals 0 is very easy to understand. Kind of integrated very strong forms. And something that I decided to make extra credit on your homework is that beyond just encoding all of the like different incarnations, like Stokes' theorem, Green's theorem, whatever names for these things, there are a bunch of them, right? Divergence theorem, whatever. It also translates all of the things that you know from vector calculus into this notation very cleanly. In particular, there's this nice little table of every operator that you could possibly need. Right? So we motivated the first relationship here. And the rest of them are also equally kind of irritating to me. Mm-hmm. If you want to prove this at home, what you have to do is essentially take F, write it in the basis, and just start grinding away. Right? There's no fun at all. Mm-hmm. But once you've done that, all of a sudden you have this nice slick notation, and you never have to do it again. That's what we do. But the question you guys should ask is like, okay, we've gone to excruciating pain to develop like nice notation for a few operators, right? And the question is it worth it? Like, what is this bias in the computational regime, right? And you know, this is supposed to be a computer science class, and somehow the last two lectures we've been developing what looks like a disgustingly theoretical object, right? Like really just like theory for theory's sake. That somehow the only nice thing that so far has bought us is that like Stokes' theorem looks kind of cute, yeah. And the reason for that is that, in fact, exterior calculus turns out to carry over really, really beautifully on a triangulated surface, or more generally, on a manifold mesh. And that's what we're going to kind of motivate for the rest of today's lecture and probably some of the next one, which incidentally is tomorrow. By the way, remember we have a makeup lecture at 1 o'clock in some room that I forgot tomorrow. That was going to be an announcement for that. It's not required. I'm going to put on a camera in the back of the room and then give you ample time before you're responsible for that material. Okay? So what we're going to do, we just built up exterior calculus, and in case that wasn't fuzzy enough in your brain, we're going to stick a qualifier in front of that and build up discrete exterior calculus. And one of the really surprising things, we've seen this a few times, like in our definition of curvature. Like, remember, defining curvature of a smooth surface was like kind of a pain in the tuchus, but then defining the curvature of a discrete thing is like summing up angles and subtracting. So a similar thing happens here. Exterior calculus is this painful, painful, famously irritating, difficult part of mathematics that all math undergrads hate. Discrete exterior calculus turns out to be like really simple. And it gets you exactly the same thing on transitive surfaces, including lots of discrete theorems that motivate smooth theorems for exterior calculus. Really clean up. And so essentially, discrete exterior calculus is the discrete version of everything we did, right? With sharps, flats. Turns out wedges are quite difficult to write in this language. We're probably going to defer on that for now, except in one special case. But certainly star and d, we can write this way. And derive things like, remember, div, grad, curl, Laplacian, and all that stuff is going to fit into just a couple simple matrices. This is really exciting. Like, if you're a math kind of student and you see this like discrete theory of exterior calculus, you should get like really excited, because we're going to show that, like, for example, d squared equals 0 is going to hold exactly in this case as well, which secretly you already proved on your homework because your instructor is kind of evil that way, although you didn't know it at the time. And this is really exciting. And then on your fourth homework, what I'm going to do is try and destroy that assignment by showing that after you go through all this work, you know, remember the Laplacian is star d star d. You can show that is exactly the same Laplacian that we were able to get to in 15 minutes using finite element. You actually don't get anything else. But it turns out this is useful for more general stuff, like div grad and curl. Yeah? Okay. So remember that a triangle mesh, as long as it's not a Mobius strip, is something we call an oriented simplicial complex. Right? You guys have already kind of dealt with this on your homework. Remember, you have these boundary operators where you kind of assign pluses and minuses depending on whether an edge is kind of forward or backward. So we assign an orientation to every element on our triangular surface. And remember that we developed something called a dual mesh. Right? So for every triangle, I'm going to replace a triangle with a vertex. For every edge, I'm going to replace this with a flipped edge. Yeah? And for every vertex, I'm going to replace that with a polygon on a triangle. Yeah? Does this start to look kind of familiar in the language of exterior calculus? See what happened here? Yeah. For every k-dimensional object, we have an n-dimensional k, n-dimensional, n minus k-dimensional object. Yeah. Okay. That's going to be the trick, is that discrete exterior calculus is going to be two copies of exterior calculus, one of which is on the primal mesh, and one of which is on the dual mesh. And this is going to be, somehow, it's going to work out really, really quite nicely this way. What operator, by the way, do you think is going to take us from the primal to the dual mesh? I'll give you a hint, it's on the board. Literally, I'm going to wait until somebody says something. Star. Thank you. Okay. Yeah. So the trick of the discrete exterior calculus is that we don't store differential forms. We store their integrals over different elements of our triangle mesh. Right? So remember, this is kind of similar to how we define curvature. Like, remember, in lecture 2 of this class, you had a curve that was composed of little line segments, and you looked at the turning angle, and that turning angle was not curvature. It was the integral of curvature over some like two little line segments adjacent to that turning point. I'm going to do something similar here. See, despite my confusion in this class, actually this class was at least constructed with the intention of fitting together quite nicely. And now we're going to start to kind of recall some of the language that we've already developed. Yeah? So first of all, we're going to start zero forms on vertices. And what is the integral of a zero form over a zero-dimensional set in a vertex? It's just the value, right? I mean, the integral over a zero-dimensional set is 1. Yeah. So a function on a surface is just 1 over per vertex, and it's the same way that we thought about it already so far. This is a primal function. Right? This is on the primal mesh. I mean, there's also a dual mesh. This is 1 over per vertex. We can think of it like a vector in R to the V. Yeah. But I'm thinking about this as the integral of my function over the vertex, but that's like kind of vanilla. Okay. A discrete one form, where do you think I'm going to store one forms? Remember, one form is kind of like vectors? Vectors one dimensional? Magic, where are going to store one forms? On edges, exactly. So for each edge, I'm going to think of a discrete one form as the integral of the one form over the edge. And conveniently, whereas a one form is some like crazy operator, the integral of a one form over an edge is just a number, right? Because we know how to do curvatures. Yeah? You can start to see how this language is much, like we can all kind of relax a little bit. This is a lot easier than what we did the first time. Okay. Finally, where are we going to store two forms on the triangle mesh? Thank you. On the triangle faces. Yeah? So there's one number per triangle. This is a primal two form. Right? So you know, I'm going to try and be careful. In discrete exterior calculus, we have to keep saying a primal this form, or a dual this form, or whatever. So you want to see something really neat? We can compute Stokes' theorem exactly. Do you get this? So let's say that I want the integral of d omega over an edge. So remember, let's say that omega is a zero form. Right, now, so d omega I think of as a one form, right? And I want the integral of d omega over an edge. What is the integral of a derivative? Well, they just kind of cancel out, right? So it's like the change in omega from one end to the edge to the other. So what is the integral of d omega? Well, it's just the value of omega on the end point of the edge minus the value of omega at the beginning point of the edge. Yeah? So in other words, if I have integrals of zero forms, I can get integrals of one forms, and I haven't made any approximations. This is actually all exact. Yeah? It's kind of nice. Right, so this is called the discrete exterior derivative. It goes from one number per vertex, one primal zero form, and gives me one number per edge, which is one primal one form. And it does so just by subtracting on every edge. Remember, this is on your homework. You guys actually implemented this option. Yeah? Okay. Similarly, let's say that I have a discrete one form. So this is the integral over every edge of a triangle mesh. And I want d of that, which is a discrete two form. But I want the integral of that over every triangle. Yeah? Well, by Stokes' theorem, if I want the integral of d omega over a triangle, this is the same as the integral of omega over the boundary of the triangle. Well, the boundary is composed of three pieces, 1, 2, 3. So it's the integral over this edge plus the integral of this edge plus the integral over that edge. But we have those integrals, yeah? You see that? So essentially, this is just an assembly of the integrals we already had. Right? Now, what is this minus sign? Well, remember that I oriented my face to go, in this case, counterclockwise. And notice that edge 2 disagrees. Right? It points down. So I put a minus in front of that to cancel it. I flip my edge back. Yeah? So this is another exterior derivative. This goes from one forms to two forms. And just by assembling minus ones and ones, you can see this is a simple matrix. So now I have two different matrices, both of which I can think of like D. Yeah, one of them goes from primal zero forms to primal one forms, one goes from primal one forms to primal two forms. And the kind of neat thing is I haven't made any approximation yet, right? Like somehow, if I know the integral of my one form on the edges, then I know the integral of d of that one form over the triangles just by Stokes. And, in fact, what you proved on your homework, remember that you implemented these two matrices, d0 and d1, and you multiplied them together, you proved on your homework you got zero. That's exactly the theorem we motivated here. Right? So this holds exactly. This discrete version of exterior calculus, you have a discrete theorem that corresponds to the same theorem that we had in 3D. Now notice that this square is a little bit suspect, right? That in fact, the d from going from a zero form to a one form is different from the d that goes from a one form to a two form. But somehow if we kind of ignore that fact, then this notation makes sense. A very common thing to do. So on your homework, what I'm going to encourage you to do is to notate it like this. That d, I'm going to say it goes from a zero form to a one form, and it goes from a primal zero form to a primal one form. So this is the way I would recommend that you notate it on your homework. Make sure that kind of the input and output of every matrix makes sense. Because it's very easy to confuse all these matrices. So remember that our hot star goes from a primal mesh to a dual mesh? Like this, yeah? In particular, let's say I have a primal two form, which is the integral of a function over a triangle. This is going to go to a dual zero form, which is this number per vertex. If I have a primal one form, this is going to kind of flip 90 degrees. Remember, we showed that's what the star does to go to a dual one form. This is all kind of fits. This all fits together really clean, super clean. This is so nice. Okay, and that's what these Hodge star matrices do. They just translate what it means for one number per element. This is going to flip you from one mesh to the other. Yeah? And this is, if you're asking, like, where do approximations appear? Because they have to appear somewhere. Like, we haven't turned into a surface. We don't have the full object. This is where they show up. Yeah? So how do you think I go from a primal two form to a dual zero form? Remember, the primal two form is kind of like the integral of something over a triangle. So roughly, if I want to cancel out integrating over a triangle, what do? You just get, like, the value of that function? I divide by the area of the triangle, right? Because roughly, integral is equal to like a number times area. Yeah? So I want to go from a primal two form to a dual zero form. All I have to do is divide by area. Very simple. Similarly, if I want to go from a primal one form to a dual one form, I have to do actually two things, right? First of all, I have to rotate by 90 degrees. That's kind of taken care of just by topologically flipping from primal to dual. But also, the dual edge might be shorter than the primal edge. So I'm going to have to take care of the ratio of those two edge lengths. Well, so let's say that I construct an edge between The circles would be these two triangles. The circle center is feathered. One thing you can show is that this is orthogonal to this edge. Then what I need is the ratio of the length of the primal edge to the length of the dual edge. Just based on what we've done the last couple of weeks, does anybody have any hypothesis what this is going to end up looking like? Just purely kind of aesthetically. What seems to show up when we take ratios of edge lengths? Cotangents! Yeah? And in fact, what you will prove on your homework is that the ratio of the primal edge length to the dual edge length is equal to 1/2 the sum of the opposite cotangents. Our favorite formula, right? This is somehow philosophically exciting and frightening all at the same time. Like, the exciting part is that like no matter what theory of geometry we use on a triangle mesh, we somehow get back to the same formula. So somehow there's been something very fundamental here. But at the same time, it's a little bit scary that we've gone to all this work to develop these theory of calculus and slowly starting to look exactly the same as what we did in finite elements. Yeah? Incidentally, this isn't the only notion of dual edge. Like, who says that the vertex has to be the circumcenter? And so, in fact, there's this really nice paper I encourage you guys to read that's all about sort of like, as I move around my dual edge, what does this hash star look like? And can I optimize my hash star for different applications? So, similarly, and then we'll stop in just a moment. If I want to go from a primal zero form, remember that's one number per vertex, to a dual two form, which is like the integral over a region, what do you think I'm going to do? Yeah, I'm going to multiply by the area of that region, right, which is roughly like the average triangle area adjacent to it. Yeah, divided by 3. And as Matt tells us, this is the barycentric area. This is not the only one. In fact, there are all kinds of different options for areas for like considering you just construct a little polygon, that's your dual cell. Each one of these corresponds to a different dual edge, right? So in fact, Matt's suggestion of the barycentric area is actually incorrect if we choose the circumcenter as the sort of location of the dual vertex, right? Then you should use the sort of circumcenter of Voronoi area instead. That turns out to be a really unpleasant hash star to compute in practice, which is why I very rarely bother. Yeah. And it can contain negative numbers, which is like the area of a triangle that shouldn't be negative. So we tend to not do that. In fact, in some literature, people have been trying to like mix barycentric area and other types of areas in order to like ensure you have positive numbers and so on. This is a detail, this really doesn't matter. But in the literature, you're going to come across all kinds of different dual cells. And the main takeaway is you should have this. You can essentially replace any one with any other and get more or less the same. Yeah. And I encourage you to, again, I'm going to remember in our lectures, we kind of have detailed part and then like pointers to other kind of interesting stuff. There's a really interesting paper, also by the same set of authors, that tries to kind of optimize your triangulation of both the primal and the dual mesh to have a nicely behaved hash star. Right, so at the end of the day, we built up this giant complex, and this has a name. This is called the Durand complex in theory, and this is the discrete Durand complex where you have primal and dual. And essentially, the D operator increases the dimensionality, and the star flips it. Right? So do you see what we've drawn in this figure here? Right? On the top, we have vertices, edges, triangular faces and tetrahedra for a volumetric object. In the bottom, I put it in reverse order, and the reason is that remember the dual cells kind of flip the dimensionality. And so the stars take you downstairs and upstairs, the D's take you to the right or to the left. And then we can define something called the Cote differential, it takes you the opposite direction. And how do you think it does that? Well, if I want to go from one forms to zero forms like that, and all I have are these sort of edges in this graph that I developed, well, then I can do star, D, star. And now I have what's called the Cote differential. Huh? Remember, what is the Lepage? It's star D, star D. Huh? What does that look like? That looks like a loop in this complex, because you better end up where you started, right? The Lepage adds some functions and gives you functions back. Yeah? So in practice, what do? In discrete discrete calculus, we build up a bunch of matrices, like D01, D12, D01 dual, D12 dual, all these different Ds and stars. And then we chain them together to make all of our favorite differential operators on surface. This includes div, grad, curl, Laplacian, Hodge Laplacian on one forms, Bachner Laplacian on one forms, all of these different ways of differentiating vector fields, or taking Laplacian and so on, all fit into this thing just by chaining together Ds and stars. So you build together these little simple operators, and then when you put them all together, you get all these complicated PDE on surfaces, which leads you to applications like the heat kernel, like all this vector field design stuff, all within one nice kind of unified set of matrices. And that's what's really clean and elegant here. As I mentioned, there are other operators, for example, this co-differential. The way to define the co-differential is that it is the operator on the other form, so that if you take their inner products, it's like taking the inner product of D on the first guy. That's how it's defined. And this gives you star D star. And in fact, if you want to get your cotangent Laplacian, that's the cotangent Laplacian is star D star. Or no, it's not D star D. Because the Laplacian is star D star D, right? Why does this make sense? Remember when we did finite elements? Right? We had the mass matrix and we had the other matrix, what's his name? The mass matrix and the stiffness matrix, thank you. Right. One of those was inner products and gradients, the other was inner products and functions. Well, what happens where the Laplacian is star d star d, that first star is the mass matrix, and the d star d is the cotangent Laplacian. Right. If I can kind of see that, right? Because what is this star? Remember, this is just containing one cotangent per edge, or two cotangents per edge. This thing is subtracting on the edge, multiplying cotangents, and then putting it back on the vertices. Remember, this is D12 on the dual two on the dual forms. Right? What is a dual two form? Is one number per vertex. Right? So you start with vertices, you end up on vertices, and then you divide by area to get back where you start. One thing that this does allow you to do, like there's a Laplacian. We have a Laplacian on functions. You could also get a Laplacian on vector fields. Right? Remember, how do we get a Laplacian? It's kind of just by following loops in this Dirac complex. For vector fields, you kind of have two loops. You have the one that goes up to the right-hand side and the one that goes to the left-hand side. Remember this kind of ladder that we built up? So to get the Laplacian on vector fields, very simple. You say d star, which goes to the right, down, across, and up, plus star d, which goes to the left, down, across, and up. And that gives you the Laplacian. What is the Laplacian on two forms on a surface? Do you guys have any ideas? Then we'll stop. So what is a two form? Well, it's just like a scalar times the area element, right? So really a two-form is just like a number per point on the surface times some complicated operator that's always the same. So really, the Laplacian on two forms is nothing more than the Laplacian on zero forms, just kind of integrated on the surface. Okay, so with this we'll stop. In our next lecture, we're going to kind of wrap up this stuff and talk about like, okay, this language is really nice, but like sometimes I actually want one arrow per triangle, right? We haven't got that in this language. I've got this weird integrating crap, and I'd like to like go back and actually just draw a picture of what the vector field looks like. So we'll talk about how to do that. This is like on the Whitney forms. And then finally, we'll talk about some applications of discrete exterior calculus that you can go home and implement. Namely, you can take a vector field and decompose it as grad of something plus rotated grad of something, which is called a Hodge decomposition. We're going to show that you can do this in discrete exterior calculus in a very elegant way, which is one of many applications. So with that, we'll stop. I'll see you, hopefully, a lot of you guys tomorrow. And